think you're crazy. Amen? Why? Because you're following the things from above and not from below. So they always think you're weird. Would you turn to Ephesians chapter 2? Ephesians 2, verse 14. You know, one of the things that we're always looking for is a breakthrough. Amen? How about a sure breakthrough? You know, there's breakthroughs that come, and sometimes they're only partial and not fullness. And there's an area where there's a process of breakthrough. So we want to get a sure breakthrough, you must follow the process. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 14, everyone say, sure breakthrough. In verse 14, let's speak it together. But when I saw that, hallelujah, when I get in the right place, I'm going to tell you. There we go. For he himself is our what? He's our what? Our peace. Who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments, contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace. And that he might reconcile both them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity or hatred. And he came and he preached peace to you who are far off and to those who are near. For through him we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers or foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Again, everyone say, I'm being built.
I'm being built.
In other words, we're not built, we're being built. There's always the process of being built. He is our peace, he's our comforter, he's our trust. The law of commandments are in me and you now. You know, people keep saying, well, I don't have to obey the commandments. Well, you do obey the commandments. Why? Because the commandments expose the acts that are displeasing to God. They're in us. They expose sin. So in this, we don't want to fall into a place where we're displeasing God or having fellowship with darkness. So the law, the commandments, are to expose those areas in every part of our life. They're in me and you. Amen. So we want to move in a place where we're always having fellowship of righteousness by the Holy Spirit with the Father. We are being built as a holy temple, a dwelling place of His Spirit. Of whose Spirit? His Spirit. A dwelling place of His Spirit to maintain and keep us connected with the Father. Maintain and keep us connected with the Father. So in this, we've got to come to an understanding to where Jesus paid an ultimate price for me and you. In everything. There was an exchange being made. And the exchange does not stop. It is a process of exchange. And where there's a process of exchange, there's this process of conversion. And there's a process to break through. In Hebrews chapter 10. You know, many times we get to a point we're about to break through and then it fails. Hebrews chapter 10. In verse 11. Is everybody there? Anybody there? Yeah. Praise God. Let's speak it. And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, who is Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God, from that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. Now, he's waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool. In other words, he has disarmed the powers of darkness if you're walking in the light. But we're to continue to come against the enemies of God. That's our responsibility in every area of our life. So by one offering, in verse 14, he has perfected forever those who are what? Being sanctified. So we're not only being built, but we're in a process of being sanctified. This process never stops. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. And he means after those days, in other words, after the fulfillment of the Feast of Pentecost, where the pouring out of the baptism of the Holy Spirit would be available to everyone. He said, I will put my laws in their hearts. Why? Brought, if you're, the Holy Spirit's living in you now, you've been baptized with the Holy Spirit, the law, the commandments are in you. He said, I will put my laws in their hearts and in their minds or in their thoughts. I will write them. Then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. Now, where there is remission of sin, there is also no longer an offering for sin. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promises is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Again, there's a process of being built. There's a process of being sanctified and being near to him. Everybody should want to get nearer to the Lord. Everybody should have a heart wanting to please God. But he gives us a key. He says, not forsaking the assembly. It is a key to breakthrough. It is the major key to breakthrough. Not forsaking the assembling of the saints. Why? Because it brings accountability, credibility, and responsibility. It brings divine order of priority. It's amazing how many people schedule everything else, their money, their business, their time, their family, everything around, everything else except for assembling. You know, the word says something very powerful. If you're not sowing in the spirit, you're sowing in the flesh. If people begin to understand this, they'd realize why they don't have full breakthroughs. Turn to Psalms 133. Psalm 133. Oh, hallelujah. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Hello. Is that assembling? Yes. Yes. It is like the precious oil upon the head. Now, I want you to understand something. He says, listen, this is the anointing. This is the anointing, which is so precious. This is the anointing that breaks the yoke. This is the anointing that empowers my children, he says. And they keep forsaking to gather together where I can't put it in them. It is like the precious oil upon the head running down the beard of Aaron running down the edge of his garments. It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountain of Zion. For there the Lord commanded what? The blessing. Life forevermore. So what's going to maintain you is the anointing. It's the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. Does everybody understand this? Again, forsake not to assemble. There's no lone stars. Amen. You can't make it on your own. I can't make it on my own. Again, how do we please God? We show him we're willing to do whatever it takes. You remember when you first got saved? We were desperate. Desperate. Wanting help. Then when we got it, began to drift. Whatever it took stopped. It's whatever, I'll give you what I can and I'll do what I want. That's sowing in the flesh. That's not denying oneself. And that's offensive to God. It's almost like people slap them in the face. I'll schedule my own schedule, thank you. Oh, really? What happens when you fall into trouble next time? Because it is going to come. Money doesn't buy your way out. Talents don't buy your way out. Work doesn't buy your way out. Knowledge won't buy your way out. Nothing will buy your way out but him. So it takes a relationship better than you ever had before. Our relationship with him should be growing, not diminishing. And too many people, it's diminishing. Because they're beginning to worship the blessing instead of the blesser. They're beginning to take care of the blessing and forsaking the blesser. They're scheduling everything around the blessing except for the blesser. Oh, they give God glory for the blessing, but he's not looking for the glory of the blessing. He's looking for the glory of humility, of not forsaking to assemble. He's looking for our worship. He's looking for us to deny ourselves. He said, it is the precious oil in the assembly of the unity of my children. This is where I give them life. I give them life. Think about this. If everybody knew that there was a medical breakthrough, that this one pill could heal everything in your body, people would give everything and anything for it. Well, there is. But it ain't a pill, it's a person. Psalm 92. Is everybody okay? Oh, happy days. Sure breakthrough. You want a sure breakthrough? Then you need to go back to do whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. And you know, one of the things the Lord will always say, show me. No, you want to do it your way. I'm asking you to do it my way. That's why he's called the way. Amen? The way. When you do it his way, truth will begin to free you. In Psalm 92 and verse 8. Everybody there, let's speak it. But you, Lord, are on high forever. For behold your enemies, O Lord. For behold your enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But my horn you have exalted like a wild ox. I have been anointed with what? Fresh oil. How did he get anointed with fresh oil? He's going to show you in a minute. Look at what fresh oil brings. My eye also will see my desire on my enemies. One of the things he's going to give you is more sight. My ears hear my desire on the wicked who rise up against me. The righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord, is that called assembling? Shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bear fruit in old age. To declare, they shall bear fruit in old age. They shall be what? fresh and flourishing, to declare that the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. Ooh. Look at anointed with fresh oil. That means renew sight. It brings renewing of your sight. It brings renewing of your hearing. It brings renewing of clarity and discernment. They shall be fresh and flourishing, joyful and prosperous in relationship with the head and the body. People need to schedule around the assembly instead of around money and everything else of the world so they can have a sure breakthrough. Anything, again, is not sowing in the spirit, is sowing in the flesh. To break through is to come out of deception and darkness. So many times people think that a breakthrough, they need a financial breakthrough, they need this breakthrough. Look, at first of all, what's brought the person in that situation is deception, is darkness. So before you can actually get a true breakthrough, sure breakthrough, you must escape. You must get a breakthrough of lies. Deception is what keeping a person in that position. Amen? Whether a person's been offended, rejected, no matter what, who cares? Well, what about me? What about you? You're supposed to be dead. Oh, hallelujah. The breakthrough is to come out of deception and what? Darkness. Psalm 43. That's why many people can't hold on. They can't wait. The reason why they're anxious is because of the lack of the anointing. Lack of anointing is because of the lack of assembling. Psalm 43, verse 1. What does it say? Vindicate me. Vindicate me. Rescue me from oppression. Rescue me from deception. Rescue me from darkness. Vindicate me. And plead my cause against an ungodly nation. Oh, deliver me from the deceitful and unjust man. For you are the God of my strength. Why do you cast me off? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of my enemy? Oh, send your what? Light and your truth. And let them what? Lead me and bring me to your holy hill, or what? And to your tabernacle or sanctuary for assembly. Then I will go to the altar of God, to my God, exceedingly joy. And on the harp I will what? I'll praise you, oh my God. Again, to vindicate is rescue from oppression, of deception and darkness, of evil influence. He said, let your light and your truth bring me into the assembly. Again, we go back to lack of assembly is lack of light. Lack of truth. Lack of refreshing in his presence so that we can see, hear, and obey. It's a lack of. The word says, the Lord is my shepherd. I will not want, or I will not lack. See, when he really becomes your shepherd, you will go after him no matter what. You will schedule everything around and away from interfering with your relationship with him. What did the psalmist say? When the doors were open, I was in there. I was glad to go into the house of God. In John chapter 8. I mean, it's a wonderful thing to worship at home and pray and so forth, but then there is a requirement for a breakthrough, and that is assembly. In verse 2, John 8, verse 2. Now, early in the morning, Jesus came again into the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. I didn't know they had cameras then. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say? This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger as though he did not hear them. I think he wrote, come out, or get behind me. So when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and he said to them, now I want you to understand, he didn't answer right away because they were in his presence. He was waiting for his presence to penetrate everyone. So he delayed anything he was going to say. He waited for the anointing to begin to penetrate each and every heart and mind and all of thick skulls. And then he stooped down and he wrote on the ground, and those who heard it, what did he say? So when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and he said to them, he who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. I guess conviction finally set in and everybody dropped their stones. I'm surprised they didn't throw them at each other. And again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Then those who heard it being convicted, being what? Convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus has raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you? She said, no, Lord. She said, no what? Lord. Lord. See, with her, he had already saw her. He saw her repentant heart. He saw what he meant to her. He was her rescuer at that time. He was her savior at that time. And when he spoke, became her Lord at that time. And Jesus was left alone with the woman and when Jesus had raised himself up and saw that no one was with her, he said, woman, where are your accusers? And she said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Go and what? Sin no more. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who what? Follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Powerful. So they were convicted by the light. His voice was light, wasn't it? He said, follow the light and you will not walk in darkness. Follow the light and you will not walk in darkness. Well, then how do people fall into darkness? Because of lack of following the light. Now remember, what does he say? You must deny yourself. Pick up the cross and what? Follow. So we must deny everything associated with our life. We must pick everything up associated with his life. And then we must follow it and put it into practice. Everything revolves around him, not me, not you, not your family, not your business, not your job, not anything else. Everything revolves around him. In Romans, let's go to 1 John chapter 1. This is what he is looking for. And don't think God knows your heart, because he does know your heart. The problem is most of us don't know it ourselves. Because the word says the heart is the most deceitful thing. Amen. So it needs to be on a constant process of exchange. In 1 John chapter 1, is everybody there? In verse 5, who is he who overcomes the world but what? Oh, I'm in 5, excuse me. 1 John, verse 5, sorry. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you that God is what? Light. And in him there is what? No darkness at all. None. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we what? Lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. Again, there is no darkness in God. We are to be practicing the truth of his word and maintain fellowship with the head and with the body. There's two accountable factors, the body, first of the head by personal, and then the body by official. Does everybody understand that? That's why God places offices. That's why you have members of the body of Christ. That's why you'll have a witness with somebody else in the body. That's why out of the mouth of what? Two witnesses, it's established. That's why somebody might come up to you and say, bro, you know what, sister, with the man, you know what? I got to tell you this, but you're out of order. Please don't take offense to this. Well, that's a warning. Believe me, the Holy Spirit was probably already telling you this. So when somebody comes up to you, it's because you're not listening to the Holy Spirit. You're rejecting his conviction. Now you got to hear from a person. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. Listen. Jesus was the pure light and had no darkness in him, but experienced the influence of the attack and pain of darkness. We not only have been captives and born in darkness, but we still have darkness in our flesh. And it's always trying to smother the light. Always. So we don't want to live a life of management. We want to live a life of dominion. That's two different things. If you're an up and down individual, then you're living a life of management. If you're still allow your emotions and the dictates of your desires and money and everything else to make your decisions instead of the Spirit of God, then you're not walking in the light. Romans 7. In verse 13. You know, when I first got asked to pastor a location, it was a drug program. I went to the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm not a pastor. You know, because they have all these traditional things. He said, you'll be whatever I tell you to be. I remember one of the people I was praying for, this woman came running up to me. We just got done praising and worshiping the Lord. I didn't, all of a sudden I opened my eyes and she was there. And she couldn't say nothing. And she was paralyzed. And she kept nudging, pray for me. And the Lord said, don't worry about it, it ain't you. I said, okay, I prayed for her and God healed her. She ran around the church and I followed her. Oh, if we could just get out of the way. If we just get out of the way. That's what he's asking us. Get out of the way. Why? Because then you're allowing him to have the last say. The little, our peanut brain is always calculating. Oh, I need to do this. I need to do that. Man, you need to die. Surrender. Deny yourself. Pick up his life. And leave your life alone. Amen? That's what it's all about. Getting rid of your life and picking up his life. Why? Because light enters light. Amen? Light enters light. It's not about good deeds. It's not how many people you rescue, how many people you feed, how many people you clothe. It's about your personal relationship with Him. That's what it's all about. How much were we obedient? And again, to be successful in the wrong assignment is terrible. See, I didn't think I was qualified. We don't qualify ourselves. He does. He qualifies. And whatever is lacking for that purpose, He will make a way for it. Did He not give the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge to the builders who built the temple? Half of these guys couldn't do nothing. Remember, what did He do with the disciples? They were fishermen, ignorant. Some of them illiterate. He turned them into trophies. That's what He's doing with everyone now. He's turning us into trophies for His glory, not for ours. Amen? Romans 7:13. Has then what is good become death to me? Certainly not. But sin, that it might appear sin, was producing death in me through what is good, so that sin through the commandment might become exceedingly sinful. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I'm carnal, sold under sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I don't practice, but what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells, because that's where darkness and deception is. It's battling with you all the time. It wants to smother the light. It wants to bring you compromise, complacency, laziness, and a reason to not to assemble. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do, but the evil I will not to do, that I practice. See, people think practicing evil is like witchcraft and things of that degree, and fornication. No, disobedience is evil. To reject any part of this word is evil. Oh, hallelujah. Is everybody there? Everybody okay? Verse 20, now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that is evil present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind or my thoughts, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ, the anointing. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God. But with the flesh, the law of the spirit. That word mind means spirit. So with the spirit, I myself serve the law of God. But with the flesh, I'm the law of sin. Sin that dwells in our flesh, which is deceptive and darkness. It's influencing our thoughts and emotions and desires and our decisions. But the anointing from the fresh oil by assembling, the key to breakthrough is breaking the power of influence, breaking the power of management, so that we can walk in the freedom of peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. How many of y'all want to make right decisions? See, there's a difference between right and righteous. We want to make the righteous decision. We may make a right decision, but we want to make a righteous one. A righteous one is one that agrees with God. A right one may agree with the world, but it'd still be right. Amen? But then there's a wrong decision. So even a right decision can turn up messed up. But the righteous one is God's responsibility, not yours. So everything we want to do, we want to fall into a righteous decision, a righteous purpose, a righteous desire. Why? Because anything that is in line with Him, He takes care of. Anything that's not, you and I take care of. Amen? John chapter 1. Is everybody all right? Sure, breakthrough. John chapter 1. How many know all things are possible to those who believe? How many know that God can do anything? He can make a way where there seems to be no way. So don't you think if everybody would start scheduling everything around assembling, that there'd be much more prosperity? There might be much more rescue? Man, I learned that years ago. And it's still baffling to me where people don't get it yet. When I ask the Lord about it, he says, because they don't know me fully. They haven't really given me their life yet. They're not sold out yet. It's a partial. So they only get partial breakthroughs. John chapter 1, verse 1. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of what? Men. And the light shines in the what? Darkness, and darkness did not comprehend it. So when darkness begins to smother light, that means darkness is taking over, and it's causing an area of lack of comprehension, lack of seeing, lack of discernment, lack of thirst and hunger. Puts a person in a lukewarm position, and a false satisfaction, and a false fulfillment. Light shines in darkness, but darkness can't comprehend, see, hear, understand, and obey. Many drift from light to darkness. And Jeremiah chapter 18. Oh, hallelujah. Now we're getting to what we're supposed to. Jeremiah 18, verse 1. Is everybody there? The words which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. What's the potter's house? You're in it. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. The wheel is the anointing. And the vessel that he had made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again into another vessel, and it seemed good to the potter to make. In other words, there were things, there were impurities. Maybe a crack. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter, says the Lord? Look at the clay is in the potter's hand, so you are in my hand, O house of Israel. You know when he speaks about Israel, he speaks about the body. Amen. The instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning the kingdom to pluck up and to pull down and to destroy it. If that nation against whom I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent of the disaster that I thought to bring upon it. Now, I want you to understand something. There's two things going on. He's not only talking about a people, but he's also talking about a nation. And the instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom to what? To build and to plant it. If it does evil in my sight so that it does not obey my voice, then I will relent concerning the good with which I said I would benefit it. Now, therefore, speak to the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saying, thus says the Lord, behold, I am fashioning a disaster and devising a plan against you. Return now, everyone, from his evil way and make your ways and your doings what? Good. You know, I want you to understand that justice and righteousness is infiltrating and invading the world right now. God is placing and replacing individuals in position. He's exposing darkness and exposing those associated with it. You know, we saw a miracle happen with this hurricane. It was a miracle. It was a divine intervention from God. But in this divine intervention, there was an operation between the U.S. military and God. He was doing something which most people won't know or understand. I shared this with our people in our campus, and I'm going to share it with you today. I mean, my heart cries for what happened in those islands in the Bahamas. Cries. See the devastation, bodies and parts. And there was a testimony of a guy who, his house was being flooded. He just wanted to save his son. He put him on the roof, and the water came and took him away. And he survived of his house. I mean, it's devastating. In that day, I was in prayer in the morning, and the Lord said to me, because, you know, the hurricane had settled over the Bahamas. And I said, why, Lord? And he said, two major reasons. The number one was witchcraft. The number two reason was, he said it was one of the largest East Coast-like demonic immigrations of human trafficking, drug smuggling. And I said, okay. And he said, I want you to pray that the submarines get exposed. I'm thinking, submarines? Then I saw in a vision these submarines going in and out of the Bahamas, carrying women and children, drugs, and so forth. And I began to pray against them. And that was that. Well, I went to my office, and I was following... there's a lot of stuff on the internet and not the news. And there was a guy that was talking and zooming in on the Bahamas. And he zoomed into a place, and there was a port, because the Lord had mentioned about ports. He said there were ports, tunnels, and marine ports and dimensional ports that they were coming in and out of. And so when this zoom in from a satellite came into the Bahamas, they showed a port that had been devastated and destroyed, and that's where the hurricane sat on. Come to find out that port was owned by China, promoted by Obama, and it was a submarine port dredged out that nobody knew. It was devastated and destroyed. It was a $3 billion port that was built. But God had a plan. See, he is bringing judgment and justice to the earth. He's going to crush what needs to be crushed and shake what needs to be shaken, whether he has to use climate, whatever. But think about this. That hurricane, we've never seen one of those like it ever in history, ever. The saints were praying against it. Righteousness prevailed it from coming up to Florida. God rejects the proud but gives grace to the humble. You know, there's a lot of things going on over there that people don't know, and that's not the only place. But there was a military operation between the Spirit of God and U.S. military that destroyed a place where women and children could no longer be abducted, imported, exported, or human trafficked. God is moving. And this is a serious time that we're in right now. And I don't think many people are taking this serious. Do not get caught up in your life, let me tell you. Don't get caught up. You'll miss what God's trying to do. So there is the potter's wheel. There is the assembling. It's essential. Justice and righteousness is invading the earth, and we are in a time of rebuild. One of the things the Lord said to me is, I will rebuild the Bahamas in my name. I will give them the opportunity to rebuild in my name. If they choose, they will see it happen again. If they refuse, they'll see it happen again. things are serious right now. He wants everything that's been built in his name to be destroyed. Everything that's been built in man's name to be destroyed. And everything that's built in his name to be rebuilt in his name to be exalted. Does everybody understand why? Because he's preparing for his return. And he's coming back for him. Does everybody understand that? Him. We're his body. What does the word say? Did anything that was built on hay or stone or everything else and money, it'll be tested by fire. Amen? But anything that was built on the anointing of Christ will last. Look at what's happened in Haiti. Look at the change over there. Look at all these places that have been hit. The major thing was witchcraft and human trafficking and drug trafficking, besides everything else. That's why these places are being hit. And you'll see more and more of these things begin to occur, because God is invading justice and righteousness in wicked places, in every area. There's three things I want to share quickly. Three areas of breakthrough. The first one, I'm going to call it, we must bow. Bow to what? Humility. Humility. It's Isaiah 66, verse 2. He says, for all those things my hand has made and all those things exist, says the Lord, but on this one will I look, on him who is poor and of a contrite spirit and who trembles at my what? At my word. That's humbleness. See, when humility says, I'm willing to do what you want me to do, I'll schedule everything around you, not around me. I don't even like to schedule dinner. My wife has a hard time with that. What do you want to eat? It's 5 o'clock in the morning. What do you want for dinner? I don't know. Hallelujah. So we need to bow, we need to burn, and we need to birth. We need to bow, we need to burn, and we need to birth, the three B's. You don't have to go there. In James 4:7, it says, submit to God and resist the devil. That means you got to burn through you. But we first got to bow to humility and humbleness. We got to burn through every circumstance. And then we have to birth. You know, one of the things that Esau did is he sold his birthright for something of the world. People are selling their birthrights and don't even know they're selling them. Well, you and I need to birth. Why? Because when the Spirit comes and begins to birth through you, what's he doing? He's birthing strategy. He's birthing a strategy in me and you to what? Overcome and get a full breakthrough. Without the strategy, it's hard to get the breakthrough. Why? Because many people don't know what to do. They don't know how to pray correctly. They don't know what to attack. They don't know what to do. God will bring the strategy. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we'll close here. Bow, burn, and breakthrough. Bow, burn, and what? Birth. That brings the what? Breakthrough. 4B. 2 Corinthians 4. Is everybody okay? Verse 16. Therefore we don't what? Lose heart. Lose heart. In other words, we don't drift. We don't get swayed. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So we are bringing those things that are not as though they are. So as we continue to bow, we continue to burn through, we will bring a birth. He will bring something to you that he's going to birth into this realm. It will be a strategy for a breakthrough. Does everybody get it? Why? Because we want a sure breakthrough. Enough partials, enough compromised. Time to reschedule for priority purposes. Amen. Divine priority purposes for divine order. Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. We ask for your forgiveness, mercies, and grace as we prepare our hearts for communion today. And Lord, bring us divine order. We all need breakthroughs, Lord. So help us to bow, burn, and birth, so that we can have the sure breakthrough that you have predestined for each and every one of us here today. And we promise to give you all the glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name. And everybody say amen.